just one aspect of something that I'm known for, which is an idea that grew out of natural influences from a lot of different sources. And I want to celebrate many of those sources briefly and skim through where some of these ideas came from. Not all of my music is extremely slow or particularly relaxing, and it's not even intended to be particularly relaxing. But around 1981, I performed the first of what became a series of concerts that lasted all night long for sleeping audiences. And I encouraged them to bring a sleeping bag and a pillow, and it was very static, very slow music, dealing with a lot of environmental sound, and really trying to remove the walls of the room acoustically to create a sort of illusionistic moving space around the mind that is inside of its own realm. Why would I be so attracted to making such slow music? I think probably it's simply personality. Some people need a lot of external stimulation, and I tend to be a person who has a little too much internal stimulation, and I find that the barrage of external noise from the world tends to cause me to just to stop thinking, really. I think that we're living in a culture where people are in such a constant state of stimulation that they essentially become numb to themselves, and they stop hearing things that are inside of themselves. There's a lot of misperceptions about relaxing music, slow music, ambient music, a term that Brian Eno coined in the mid-70s. People think that it's anti-intellectual, that it's sort of opiating and you know, sort of dopes people down. The idea of Muzak being a kind of you know, shopping zombie, you know, the Stepford Wives model of music. And a lot of people claim that music has various healing properties, and you'll see, you know, a whole section in New Age record stores of, there's an old world record store, you know, healing or health music and things. You know, my problem is a lot of that stuff drives me up the wall. Healing for whom? If it's annoying, it's not going to heal you. It could be that, that going to a death metal concert is going to heal some kid of his aggressions, you know. So I'm not going to claim that anything is medicine unless it is for you. And for me, I think a certain kind of peace around sound is necessary for me to find my own place. I think my own music becomes a kind of bubble, a sanctuary of silence. In fact, my wife can tell you that I don't listen to much music. I don't have an iPod on when I'm walking down the creek trail. I just like to listen to the birds, even the traffic or the weather. There's a very influential book that came out in the mid-70s called The Soundscape, The Tuning of the World, a Canadian composer, R. Murray Schafer. I discovered when I was working on this talk that I actually don't own the book. I'm kind of embarrassed. It's on order right now. I can't seem to find it. This book pretty much is a composer's complaint about where have we come to? What have we done to ourselves? He has gone on to do very important work with the World Soundscape Project, something of his invention, where he collects recordings that people have made and contribute from all over the world. He writes on the very first page of the book, "Modern man is beginning to inhabit a world with an acoustic environment radically different from any he has hitherto known. An indiscriminate and imperialistic spread of more and larger sounds into every corner of man's life. The world's soundscape has reached an apex of vulgarity in our time." So in this way, he's actually standing himself apart from a composer like John Cage, who was trying to get us to embrace all of sound and call music anything which is organized sound. He's actually saying what we need to do is discriminate between sound that is, in his terms, imperialistic. The sound of an airport he refers to as imperialistic because it dominates a landscape. It prevents the life around it from existing in a healthy way. So this idea of being able to delineate what sound is doing to us and what we are doing to the world with the sound that we make, it's a kind of consciousness that I found to be very, very useful. regarding this idea that calm, slow music is anti-intellectual. Personally, I find that a kind of slow stimulation in sound, this idea of creating a bubble, an acoustic bubble, actually helps me move more freely in my mind, and it becomes an aid to the intellect. I try very hard in my music, and I don't even know how to quantify or qualify how I decide something is soporific or stimulating, but I try very hard in my music to make something which is stimulating and not soporific, yet something which entices us to listen deeply, which is, to me, an awakening of the senses, not a nullifying them. It's not mollifying or opiating the senses. I'm trying to stimulate the senses by inviting us to listen to something that is more quiet and more detailed. And in this way, there's in this thread of ideas, there's a lot of commonality in the modernist movement of minimalism and the idea that art can point away from itself and back into the viewer or the experiencer of that art. Art which somehow creates a place of concentrated awareness of the senses. I think one of the greatest examples of that would be the light artist James Turrell, who does installations. One of his great works is Sky Room, where he creates a wall around nothing. And there's a ceiling which is carefully delineated as a hole to the sky. And you walk into this room, and you notice things about the sky, the dome of color, the shading, gradation of light created by the atmosphere that you don't notice when you look without this circle around you. I think that you'll see towards the end of the talk, I'll be referencing a lot of people who have influenced me in these ideas. So when we think about slow listening, or as Paulina Oliveros terms, deep listening, there's a few ideas that I'm operating from. I'm not saying that these are locked in concrete. I'm not claiming that this is how the mind works. It's maybe how my mind works. I find that rather than barraging people with wide amounts of information in a multimedia style format, for example, like pictures and words, you know, I personally think that PowerPoint deadens talks. It makes people listen with their eyes. I kind of hate PowerPoint. For those reasons, when I teach classes, I like to pull away all multimedia and just have people listen and make eye contact. So I'm more interested in narrow focus and deep, like microscopic analysis of small things. I find myself to be far more inspired by lifting up a rock and looking at the insects crawling underneath than I am by a barrage of light and sound like at a rave. With loud PA systems and lasers and strobes. I find actually in those loud environments, I shut down. In a quiet environment, I wake up. One reason I explain that to myself is that I think of the experience of making art and the experience of appreciating art, engaging with art. To be one, I think, to back up a little bit, I think that we often use the wrong metaphor. I think that people imagine that the artist is like a delivery person carrying a basket of eggs and handing it to you and saying, here's my art, and you crack the eggs and you eat them. And this metaphor tends to cause us to become passive. If we want to become active, engaging with the art, with our mind and with our full self, I think if we use a metaphor that's more like a muscle, that the aesthetic muscle is something that we exercise by appreciating the world. And when art gets us to do a new exercise, just like you know, you go to a class at the gym and they get you to stretch in a way that you've never done before, it's really difficult the first few times, and then it becomes easy, and you slowly develop new sets of muscles. I think that's what art can do for us. If we use this metaphor of engaging with the art as a muscle, not as a receptacle of something to pour into us. I think that multimedia is a big problem. And we can get a lot more out of the world by focusing. Close our eyes. Go inside. I'm much more interested in creating an aesthetics of self-discovery rather than simply entertaining people. I'd like them to find it beautiful also. But really, if they can engage with my music, they're going to get something much more interesting out of it. This, by the way, is a wine label. A friend of mine runs this winery. The sensorium is this wonderful 19th century idea of the place in our mind where we bring all of the senses together. In the 20th century, there was this idea of gestalt, the idea that there is a place where we can have a creative thought which is without sensory modality, that we can think beyond the separate senses. Oftentimes, when I'm coming up with a musical idea, it doesn't start as a sound. It doesn't start as notes on paper. It starts as a texture. Sometimes I feel it on my skin. I know that it's cold or wet or metallic or squishy. And oftentimes, in the sensorium, these creative things come from active world building. And at night, when we dream, we practice world building. We do it every night. When we imagine a new thing, which we do constantly, we are world building. Throughout the history of human consciousness, what we've seen from cave paintings on Lascaux to shamanism to trance ritual, and the role of music throughout these times, has been about journeying between states of mind, states of consciousness, transitioning to help us practice world building, perhaps. I think that art can be one of these things which can help us to naturally shift between states. So there's, of course, an association of some psychedelic music with drug movements, the 60s, and certainly it did change a lot of people's expectations of what music could do. LSD especially, and in rave scenes you'll see a lot of MDMA and other rather intense drugs I've seen. And there is an association with a lot of these thoughts with psychedelics. I find that what we have in us is an innate ability to transition between states. UC Davis Professor Charles Tart, starting in the 1970s, did some very important research with state psychology and showed that, in fact, states of consciousness are constantly shifting throughout the day. We have frames of expectation, and merely a daydream or playing a video game or sex or going for a walk, these involve different states of consciousness, different modalities. So we don't need to look at psychedelic culture to create psychedelic music, because the psychedelic experience is intrinsic to us. It's not something that comes in a pill. And I'm very, very interested in the idea of exploring states of consciousness, states of awareness, through sensory stimulus. So I started involving myself with long-form audio as a kid. I was a nerdy kid building synthesizers starting around 13 years old in the mid-70s. And I was at the time living at my grandparents' place, who had passed away, and there was a creek running through the garden. And that recording you just heard was a recording that I made on cassette back around 1977 of the frogs in the creek on a rainy spring night. I started listening to the frogs, and they actually taught me polyrhythms. They taught me ways of hearing interlocking patterns, and it's changed the way I hear music. They taught me a lot. For me, it started as a very internal, a very private experience. As I started becoming influenced by some of the art of the time, I realized that sleep was a very interesting place to explore. I ended up going to Stanford and working at the Sleep Research Center there. Worked with Stephen LeBarge doing lucid dreaming research. And this all tied in. I had already started doing sleep concerts by that time. This is an example of what a sleep concert might sound like around 3 or 4 in the morning, but quieter than this. A lot of this comes from my version of where ambient trance music comes from. And now for the next, what we have about 8 minutes perhaps, I'll quickly run down a list of inspirations and show you what some of the music sounded like. First of all, the idea of long form music comes long before modern art music. I think that if you look at the origins of music, it's probably taking two roles. One is in social ritual, the other is in trance and shamanism. Storytelling, courtship, communal, village entertainment is one role that music plays. The shamanic role is the one I'm more interested in, the role of trance induction, medicine. This is a Navajo medicine man from a photograph from the turn of the century, last century. The Navajo would have medicine rituals, still practice them. Things like the blessing way, which lasts 4 days. And these medicine men are not improvising. They have to memorize 4 days worth of chanting. And a slight mistake will invalidate the ritual and prevent its healing magic from working on the patient. So these are very specialist positions. I'd like to thank Charles Amarkanian, who was music director here at KPFA back in the 70s and 80s, for introducing me to a lot of the people I'm going to show you next. Also, KPFA had an amazing world music broadcast, which I believe they still do. Classical Indian music, Indonesian music. This is where I started learning about all-night rituals. For example, the Wayang in Indonesia, which is the reenacting of the Ramayana. And this is one of my favorite recordings of Indonesian gamelan music from the courts of Solo in Central Java. Also in Indian music, you'd have all-night concerts of ragas. I mentioned the Navajo blessing way and other ceremonies that last for days. Also, even in the Christian European West, you'll have rituals of the Stations of the Cross and the Holy Days where people will stay up for days and they'll sing and chant, the monks and the practitioners. So within the realm of sacred music, these things are long, deep traditions. In the 20th century, we started having a schism, I would say, in modernism. One half, there was the path of complexity. Schoenberg, Milton Babbitt, people like this, creating more and more intense atonal works. At around the same time that Schoenberg was starting, you had Debussy, Raphael, people doing much more tonal, poetic works. And mavericks like Harry Parch in the United States, he said there was a fundamental atonality to Western music. He started building his own instruments with new tuning systems. This was very influential on me, the idea of just intonation, which I've talked about for Leonardo before. You had the American gamelan movement, people like Lou Harrison, who just passed away about 5-8 years ago. Wonderful man. John Cage, an interesting case. This is a composition by John Cage from the 1930s called In a Landscape, performed by a West Coast gamelan group. He was also an extreme atonalist. In fact, he wanted to democratize tone. But he was also capable of some extremely beautiful compositions. In the 60s, we started having a very new series of ideas. Fluxus movement was extreme performance art. There was a fellow named Richard Haven who would wire himself up in a hammock with whistles in his mouth, and he would actually fall asleep in front of the audience. And the whistles would convey his breathing. When I first read about this in the mid-70s, I thought, man, that's kind of lazy. It should be the other way around, shouldn't it? Well, unfortunately, that means that I have to stay up all night, which isn't much fun. But hearing about his sleep concerts where he fell asleep was one of those little incentives. The happenings in the 60s, things like the Exploding Plastic Inevitable and the Grateful Dead and the Ken Kesey's acid tests, these were a form of all-night trance ritual, weren't they? Much more of a full-on sensory overload. What you just heard, though, while I was talking, was Lamont Young, who started in the 60s even he says in the late 50s, although nobody heard about him then, doing drone music, extremely minimal, pure tones. What you see in this purple picture is one of his rooms where he would have sound happening all the time, and people could come and go. It would often very, very loud, but pure tones, they would ring and create standing waves. Terry Riley, I'll show him the next slide, huge, huge influence on me. Also, he would perform all-night concerts of organ improvisations with tape loops. Bill Fontana and other landscape artists also would do sound installations. Bill Fontana was a person who, sometimes he's living in the Bay Area, doing recording of environments and relocating them to places like museums. So for example, he did an 8-track recording with 8 microphones spread across almost a kilometer distance on the Great Barrier Reef, and then set it up in a museum with 8 speakers positioned only, you know, down a hallway. And so you could hear the passage of the wave that had originally taken, you know, a long distance, filling up just maybe a 100-foot length. Extremely, extremely interesting work that he did. This is Terry Riley's Descending Moonshine Dervishes, one of my favorite pieces of his from about 1975. He's credited with inventing minimalism with a piece called In C in 1964. The entire piece fits on one piece of music paper, and it gives instructions to repeat phrases over and over again for an ensemble of any number of musicians. And it's quite a miraculous piece of music. He also was a person who inspired me to study Just Intonation, along with Harry Parch. This organ piece is not in equal temperament. It's in pure intervals. And I find it to be very expressive. Terry's also a local. Now he lives up in Grass Valley. Sometimes he lives down in the Oakland Hills. He's one of the most beautiful people I've ever met. Amazing man. Slightly on the more experimental tip, Anea Lockwood, I first learned about her KVFA in interviews that Charles Amarkanian did with her. She was one of a number of artists who were using sound as a way to get people to think differently about environment and about their expectations. She did many crazy works with piano, including lighting them on fire with microphones inside of them, dropping them from a helicopter, planting them in the garden and listening to them as they slowly decompose, as in this case, alder trees grow up through the piano and eventually maybe lifted up into the sky. She did a piece that I heard on the radio called Delta Run, where she interviewed Walter Winchell, who was a sculptor, a day before he died of cancer, and he was discussing death. And she interspersed with recordings of people going about everyday life. An amazing piece of work. This is a study of glass that she did in 1970. Small studies of different things to do with glass. This album probably had more to do with my sound than any other thing that I can point to. Very strange album. I discovered it in a cutout bin in 1975, and it's a recording of an Aeolian harp. 2 records set. It sounds like this for an hour. It is absolutely breathtaking, and it pretty much tore my head off and changed the way I heard things. An irony is that the director of The Exorcist discovered this album around the same time, and it's used for scary music. I didn't even know that until I was researching this talk. I never, ever thought the music sounded scary to me. I'm not sure. I think this tells me a lot about context and how expectations are changed by placement. Paulina Oliveros is the one who I quote as creating the phrase deep listening. That's a picture of her at the Tate Music Labs in San Francisco in 1963, where Terry Riley was also located. She's still alive. She teaches at Rensselaer in New York. And she also uses Just Intonation. Very interesting fact that a lot of these people who focus on tone and deep listening are looking at intonation as a way of expressing a new kind of harmony, new sort of expression, a new kind of beauty. The idea of deep listening is not the same as the idea of ambient music. We need to give Brian Eno a lot of credit for consolidating many ideas in history of modernism into something very easily digestible. But what I like about the idea of deep listening is that the term turns it back to you and asks you, how are you going to engage with the art? I like that. Alvin Lucier, also very, very influential sound artist. Two pieces he did which huge influences on me. I'm Sitting in a Room is a piece where he re-recorded his voice over and over and over again until the acoustics of the room became like a gong. The voice goes away entirely. What you're hearing here is a piece called Music on a Long Thin Wire. 50-foot long piece of wire strung up in a shopping mall. I think this was in Vancouver. And he was studying the way that the overtones blend into complex dissonances and harmonics. It's a very, very powerful piece of work. It's also something that was up for 3 months, so he's probably got it on me by several weeks on duration. This piece here is an immediate predecessor to my first Leap concert. I was a freshman at Stanford University, and I heard this on KPFA in my dorm room. I slapped in a cassette, and this is the cassette recording that I made off the radio. I met Marianne Amiche. She passed away just about a year or two ago. She was quite a nutcase, really, really unusual person. She was creating here electronic sounds from the ambient background noise of the area around Walden Pond, while John Cade was reading randomizations of Henry Thoreau's Walden. So that's what he sounds like. My wife thinks he sounded psychotic reading this. It's very, very strange cut-ups. And so what they did is an all-night 12-hour performance, September 25th, 1981, where they did this for 2.5 hours. Then they took a half hour break where people would nibble on some food and have some tea. And then they go again for 2.5 hours for 4 different intervals.
Class 69 degrees.
And you'll notice a common element with many of these sound samples. The cloud. The fog, the drunk.
On the edge and read from INRE charts, y'all course who sticks for.
So when I heard that recording and I stayed up all night and listened to how that affected me, became very, very altering of consciousness. And I decided to try it. And so this is a picture that my friend Rick Davies took of me doing my very first Sleep concert. This was in early February of 1982. And this was in the dormitory that I was living in. And I got a bit notorious for this. I was only 18 when I did that. And this seems to come around about every few years and people want me to do one again. I'm getting a little old for these. But that's some of the predecessors to this idea. I really want to celebrate this general idea of deep listening and slow excursion into trance, into altered consciousness. Thanks.